Welcome back to Dave's Gone By, and Dave's got guests, a musical guest with us, who is getting to theater now by doing an off-Broadway show as part of the New York International Fringe Festival. It's actually a show that's been around for a couple of years that they've been working on. I want to talk to him about that. It's a show called Die, Die, Diana, but also about his musical career, because he's worked with people like Bonnie Raitt and the strange and mystical and completely unguessable Van Morrison. So, please welcome to Dave's Gone By my guest, Jeff Rabus. Hi, Jeff.
Hello.
Oh, you're on a cell phone. I can hear that.
Yeah.
Where are you right now?
I'm in Marin County.
Marin County in
yeah, North of
San Francisco. Okay. We're not quite getting you there. Pointing away from the trees. Oh, there you go. I can hear a laugh. So tell me, how's Diana going?
Well, I've only seen two reviews. One review was really good, and one review was really bad. So I guess it's somewhere in the middle.
Was the bad one about politics, or was the bad one about specifically the content?
The bad one was kind of dealing with performance a lot, and quality of the actors. They also didn't like the music much.
Oh, ouch.
But the good review seemed to like everything. So, you know, it was very subjective business, being a reviewer.
Now, why don't you actually tell people what Die, Die, Diana is about?
It's a satire that kind of alleges that the royal family had a lot to do with the demise of Princess Diana.
Wow. Is it something you believe or just something that you're playing with?
Well, actually, the play was written by Scott Sublett, my partner,
mm-hmm.
and he called me in to do the music. I personally feel that he's on to something, and actually there's been a lot of things coming through the press in recent years since her death that indicate that there may be some substance to it as well.
Who would have done it? Dodi's family or something like that, or the government, or?
Oh, the royal family. She was about to move to Malibu, California, with Dodi, and take Prince William with her. And Prince William, of course, is the next in line because they're passing over Charles. So it made perfect sense for the royal family to be upset with him running around the beaches of Malibu.
And so Scott Sublett, the guy who wrote the book, the libretto for, he also wrote the lyrics, or did you write the lyrics?
He wrote the lyrics as well.
So he had it in his head to go and explore this and see, well, was
yes.
Princess Diana killed rather than just this accident done by paparazzi?
Well, the piece explores the issue of fame and being chased down by the paparazzi, who may have had something to do with the accident as well.
And it does it in a comical, satirical way, I assume.
Yes. Yeah, the whole thing is definitely a satire. When we put it on at San Jose State here in the Bay Area, where Scott is a professor of screenwriting, by the way, we had the director, Danny Shea, who's a fabulous director, and he really made it a most entertaining evening. It was sold out on a three-week run.
And again, I was back in San
this
Jose.
This was about 4 years ago.
You also did play in England, or wanted to.
No,
what happened with that?
We had a producer who wanted to do it in England, but he found out from his lawyer that he was likely to be sued, or at least possibly sued.
Well, actually, the press material said that the show is banned over there for possible sedition,
or is that? That it could be looked at as seditious.
So you couldn't even do it there now, or if you wanted to?
Well, it's a question of the producer would be liable for being sued.
Well, who would sue? The royal family?
Well, that would be possibly the source of a suit, yeah.
Wow. How did you get together with Scott Sublett? Because he was teaching in the area where you were, or?
Well, actually, he's a friend of another collaborator of mine with whom I've written about four shows.
Oh, what were those?
Well, we wrote a children's version of The Odyssey,
mm-hmm.
and we wrote a version of Little Women, which we've done with middle school kids,
mm-hmm.
and a version of Tick Tock of Oz, and Rumpelstiltskin, all children's theater.
So, did your musical career, is that your daughter, son, other?
My youngest son.
So, did you get into music very, very early in your life and then decide pretty quickly it was going to be a career, or how did that all come about?
It was kind of accidental. I was playing music professionally from the age of about 13. And band during my teenage years, and interrupted college for a while to join a band that was recording in New York City. We became the house band for the club, famous club in New York, The Bitter End.
Was this Caldwell Winfield? Or
no, actually, I worked with them later on. This band was called the Apple Pie Motherhood Band. And yeah, we did two albums with Atlantic Records.
Oh, okay.
Back in the days of The Cream, and as a matter of fact, Felix Pappalardi was our first producer.
Oh, gosh, okay.
And we got invited to Cream sessions, which was kind of fun. And, you know, we'd walk in the studio and Aretha was just leaving, or the Young Rascals. It was a very exciting time.
And how come that band only released, I mean, what happens with bands?
Just... Well, we kind of parted the company with our manager over business issues during the release of the second album, which was produced, by the way, by Tom Dowd. I understand there's a great film about him now circulating.
Tom Dowd? Okay.
Tom Dowd, yeah, he was one of the legendary producers of Atlantic. Joined Caldwell Winfield after spending a couple years with the Apple Pie guys, and they got me to Woodstock, New York. They all lived up there, and as a matter of fact, during the Woodstock Festival, we were playing in Montreal, across the border. Everybody was coming south, and we were going north.
And then, at some point, you hooked up with a fella named Van Morrison.
Yeah, the drummer in the band was jamming with Van and doing some appearances with him. So he introduced me to Van, and we put a new combo together for Van. He had just released Astral Weeks, which kind of went nowhere at the time. I think it sold about 10,000. It's gone on to be in print ever since.
Well, it's probably one of the greatest albums in the history of rock and roll.
I think so, too.
And actually, let me read this to you. This is from a 1974 interview with Donald Corvin, around the time when Van was working on Veed and Fleece, and he said, quote, "I first got together with this piano player, Jeff Labus, and he's been playing on and off on my records and gigs for a long time, since before Moondance. He's like a friend. He does his own thing, I do my own thing, and sometimes they meet. Sometimes they meet in the middle, and we play together. We met in Woodstock and jammed together. He was playing with Caldwell Winfield, and we did this gig together in Woodstock, and this was the original Woodstock Festival, which they have every year. Didn't have anything to do with
the
movie.
Out.
Yeah, with the movie. I mean, this is still being quoted. He's saying it didn't have anything to do with the movie at all. It's in a little muddy field, and they had the festival every year, and it was really mellow. Not many people there, just enough, and the movie just ruined the town completely." Unquote. So Van was talking about you at that period. Were you friends, or is it impossible to be friends with Van?
Oh, no, we were friends. Actually, I even stayed with him for a while between the living arrangements.
Really?
And,
lived with
him? Yeah, he's a terrific guy.
Huh.
You know, I mean, people look at him as complicated because the public face he puts out is complicated by his vision of what a performer ought to be, or the respect that a performer ought to have. I mean, he looks at it as it's a job, like any other job, and it doesn't make you a god or anything.
Well, cleaning windows kind of thing, yeah.
Exactly.
But he, I mean, the public persona is beyond that. Public persona is he is so difficult and so dislikable that one little thing could turn him into a complete tyrant. And he's shown that on stage.
He's had some funny moments. I can tell you a funny story. Before I ever met him, when I was back in my Bitter End days, he appeared at the Bitter End. And I was there for his opening show. And the way I remember it is that the band was playing. He had a good band, too. And he was introduced, he walked on the stage, looked at the audience, and walked right off the stage and out into a taxi.
And this was before he was anybody with older, I mean, I think then
he already had Brown Eyed Girl.
Oh, okay.
On the charts, and he had several songs from them. Well, he had quite a big career before he was even 20 years old.
But you knew him at that point. I mean, you were living with him for a point. Did you ever talk to him and say, Van, since it is your job, and since you are just, a hired person to do what you do, which happens to be write songs and play music, why the attitude? Why, the disgust?
Well, actually, back in the days when I was first getting to know him, and, as I said, I crashed for a while at his house, I didn't know of any real difficulty that he had, you know, except that interesting story that I, you know, that I had seen him do. But no, he was a complicated guy because I think it was based on the fact that he had been in the public eye since he was 16 years old when he started the group Them.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, he toured all around Europe, and they were local heroes in. He was actually from Belfast, and some of the other guys were from Belfast as well. But they were local heroes in England, and I think he was kind of fed up with the fame aspect of the business pretty early. He had gone past a lot of the youthful indiscretions, and kind of had grown up. And with that attitude, he had a more of a cynical attitude about the business.
And the whole born-again sort of religious thing, did that also happen when you knew him? Was he torn between sort of the heaven and hell aspects of a normal human personality, or
that
not
was
yet?
Going on for him in the 70s, I believe.
Well, you were still playing on his albums. Well,
yeah, I would come in and out. I took a couple of years off starting in 1970, and I moved to Israel.
Oh.
Part of it was a reaction to the rock scene that I had been running around in. It appeared quite jaundiced to me, actually. And I had occasion to tour with the Zamir Chorale in Israel.
Mm-hmm.
And I noticed how refreshing it was. You know, this was back in the early days of Israeli politics. It was just after the 67 war.
Right.
Things were very exciting there. The West Bank had just opened up to people from the Israeli side, so you could come in and pretty much freely go anywhere. And the Palestinians were very welcoming of the business. So it was kind of a great place to be.
And you stayed
there?
Oh, sorry. Yeah.
It contrasted with the scene back in the U.S., I guess. I also was uncomfortable with the Nixon administration.
Who wasn't? Yeah. So, but you stayed in Israel not for a couple, you were living there for a couple of years, and then you moved back, or you
yeah,
back
I spent a couple of years there, and I moved back in 72. And my good friend Daoud Shah had been doing a lot of work with Van. He's a fabulous drummer and producer. I guess he told Van that I was back in the country, and within a day or two that I arrived in New York, I got a telegram, give me a call.
Cool.
So I called him up. I hadn't spoken to him in a couple of years, and he said, what are you doing? Come on out to California. Let's do some recording. So I found myself in Northern California. That's when I started my love affair with Marin County, actually.
And also the Americans' real love affair with Van Morrison began with Moondance. I mean, Brown Eyed Girl, of course, but...
Yeah, well, we had done Moondance back in 1970.
Right.
Which was a very exciting time. We actually recorded that particular song about a dozen times at least.
And
we kind of, he ended up using the very first recording.
were you the piano on that?
Yeah.
And did you arrange it?
I did quite a bit of the arrangements, worked with the horn players, yeah.
Wow.
Actually, the horn players came from the Caldwell Winfield Band.
And you did a lot of the other pianos and arranging on that album as well. Plus,
yeah, I did the QA. Well, actually, the funny part about this, when we first started recording an album, we used the same players that played on Astral Weeks. It was a really good band, but the reaction was, oh, it's the same sound as Astral Weeks. We don't want to do that, even though it happened to be the addition of my keyboard playing.
Right.
So Van decided, you know, it was his, he actually had a producer, but he was pretty much taking the reins, and he was going through a sort of breaking of the ties with his production company.
Mm.
He decided to make it something closer to what we were doing on stage to be very successful with the audiences. So it became more of a pop sound than Astral Weeks.
Well, no one can say it was the wrong decision because it remains perhaps his best-known song and most
probably
popular
best-known
album.
Yeah.
So you were not just on Moondance. Once you got back from Israel, you ended up on five or six of his recordings, including...
The first thing we did was... he had his own studio at that point in his backyard in Fairfax, California.
Mm-hmm.
We started recording a lot of things, and some of them became the album Hard Knows the Highway,
which I happen to love. It seems to be a lesser known one, but great stuff on it.
Yeah, I like it too, but it's been neglected, I think, among his albums. Among those many things we recorded, a lot of the tracks came out on a much more recent release of previously unreleased tunes called Philosopher's Stone.
Right, that's a two-disc.
It was really satisfying that many of those tunes came to light about 25 years later.
And then
we went on and did the Beaten Fleas album, which was kind of going, taking him back toward the Astral Week side.
Yeah.
More of a jazz business. And I actually came out after a lot of tracks had been cut with a very, very fine keyboard work. So I just did the arranging. He actually just called me out to arrange. I was still living in New York and studying at Juilliard, actually. And
Well, you were still relatively young, I guess. You were still, in your
20s? Yeah. Yes, I was before 30.
But this is already after you've gotten back from Israel. So you've had already a life, and then you go back to Juilliard? Were you going to teach, or what was the...
I just wanted to get my my chops together for writing. I had decided that my rock and roll days were pretty much going behind me, although at that point I was working with Bonnie Raitt and enjoying touring with her and...
I assume a very different personality from Van?
Very different, yes.
What's she like?
But also very creative and wonderful. Wonderful person and a great performer.
Any good Bonnie Raitt anecdotes or stories or memories?
You know, it was kind of a who's who of people to tour with. The people opening the shows for Bonnie were always wonderful, from ranging from Mose Allison to Little Feat to... Jackson Browne. Sometimes we open the shows for them. You know, they're always well chosen acts. Michael Franks, who you know became one of my heroes as I moved into jazz, realized what a tremendous songwriter he is. It was a great time. Wonderful people to work with, and we kind of did 3 years and then sort of moved apart. I moved out to L.A. during the course of recording an album with her in Hollywood. And, you know, actually, I had been working for Saturday Night Live on their very first season, writing encore music for the band. Because my friend Dawood was playing drums in the band.
Oh, my gosh.
And,
the first, that very, very, that was, again, that was
first
back
season,
in 74,
yeah. With the Aykroyd and,
Belushi.
And Belushi days, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, George Carlin was on the first episode. I remember that one, yeah.
That's right, yeah.
And he's,
yeah. George was actually a friend of mine from back in New York.
Do you have any stories of those Saturday Night Live days, or were you not really involved in the cast at all because it was the band thing, but still?
No, you know, I was at a bunch of tapings, and they were very exciting.
Well, yeah.
It had the feeling of, you know, kind of a new era in television. I was a big fan of That Was the Week That Was.
Oh, sure.
I thought that was some of the best television that had been... It had been presented, and it felt like it was definitely in that tradition. You know, a lot of young people. Lorne Michaels was very young, and it was great. Howard Shore was the music director. He was a great guy to work for.
He was my
boss. He's gone on to a fabulous career in films.
Howard Shore.
He did the music for the Lord of the Rings.
Oh,
films.
Yeah, have you done movie scoring?
Actually, I have some spotty work in films. I did a redone main title for a film called The Stud.
Okay.
Which was a previously English release, and they wanted a different score for America. And
is that Joan Collins? What's her name? Wasn't that
Joan Collins?
Yeah, it was Joan. Okay, cool.
Yeah.
No, all right. A job's a job, you know.
And while I was living in L.A., I got to do quite a few TV spots. Like, I did a lot of cartoons, actually. I worked for Saban Productions as a ghostwriter for a couple of years. And at that point, I had cartoons on all the networks running simultaneously, everything from The Littles to Heathcliff to Get Along Gang. Whole position. There was a whole list of shows.
It was kind of like what Mark Mothersbaugh has on Nicktoon or Nickelodeon. I mean, every other show is his music coming through. But
yeah, they were a lot of fun. You know, for a keyboard player, it's easy to do that because you can. Those were the early days of the emulator and instruments where you could replicate orchestral instruments. So we had a lot of fun. I left L.A. In the mid-80s, came up to Marin County, where I found life to be a lot more spacious on a spiritual level. There isn't quite. I mean, there's always the pressure to keep it going, but there isn't as much pressure to hit the heights of success. So I've been very very comfortable with a more leisurely pace, and I've gotten into a lot of theater. That's what got me into theater. I did some theater in L.A. as well, but up here I've been writing musicals at a pretty fast pace. I've written about 15 of them in the last decade.
Oh, my gosh.
And they've all been produced, which is really nice.
Mazel tov, yeah. Well, are any
all
of
got enough, except for I'm waiting for two new ones. But so it was very exciting to have this this show at the Fringe Festival.
Let me remind people, actually, that it's Die Diana, playing at the
Die Diana, Fringe. Which a title which we were it's a very cynical title, and I never felt comfortable with. We actually were going to change it to Diana the Musical.
I think there was one, though. That was a problem. I think there was a Lady Di musical.
That could be, too. But Kelly McAllister, who is producing and directing this current production, decided that the title was too good to leave because it does attract publicity.
Let me remind folks also that it's playing at the Schimmel Auditorium, and you've got two chances left to see it. On Saturday, August 21st at 10:45 at night, and then again Friday night, August 27th at 10:45 at night. So do give it a look. Die Diana, satirical,
It's a very funny piece.
It doesn't mean to offend, but it does mean to stick a few jabs in all the different parties involved, I'm sure.
Well, except for Diana. We were trying to be really, really sweet to Diana because we felt that she was a victim. I think we were respectful of her.
Let me ask, just going back one more time to the music. When was the last time you were in touch with you-know-who?
With Van?
Yeah.
I haven't seen him for a couple of years. He comes through Marin every year or two, and we always got together for a coffee or something, or a meal. We had a nice jam session up at his house, must have been 4 years ago or so. I think Dave Hayes was in, too, his bass player. And that was really fun. And I was going to go out and do another tour with him. The most recent one I've had done with him actually was in as far back as, I believe it was 89.
Well, okay, but I mean, you've known each other since the early 70s, so that is still pretty good that you're in touch.
Oh, yeah, well, the latest album I did with him was in 86, and we did a big tour following that.
Was that No Guru?
That was No Guru, yeah.
That's a pretty nice album, too, actually.
And then in 89, we went to, we played at the Beacon Theater in New York, and we played at the Jazz and Heritage Festival in New Orleans.
Wow.
And that was really fun.
Well, it has been much, much fun talking to you, Jeff Labus. I want to wish you best of luck, not only with Die, Die, Diana the musical, but all the other musicals that you seem to be putting out and all your other musical projects. I want to thank you.
Well, thank you so much, Dave.
You betcha. Have a good one.
Good to talk to you. Okay, bye-bye.